Hello, everyone, and welcome. Thank you for joining the Birnbaum Women's Leadership Network, the Peter L. Zimroth Center on the Administration of Criminal Law at NYU, and the Institute for Public Knowledge at NYU for a virtual book talk on the feminist war on crime, the unexpected role of women's liberation in mass incarceration by Colorado law professor Aya Gruber, in conversation with Dr. Rachel Wechsler, a research fellow at the Zimroth Center. My name is Madeline Jory, and I'm the interim executive director at the Birnbaum Women's Leadership Network at NYU School of Law. The Birnbaum Women's Leadership Network is a center at the law school that works to remedy gender inequities in the legal profession through innovative leadership training and conversations like these. The Peter Zimroth Center on the Administration of Criminal Law at NYU aims to promote good government practices in criminal matters with a special focus on the exercise of prosecutorial power and discretion through a mix of academic and public policy research and litigation advocacy. At the Institute for Public Knowledge at NYU nurtures collaboration among social researchers in New York and around the world to bring together serious scholarship to bear on major public issues. We're so grateful to Professor Aya Gruber and Rachel Wechsler for joining us tonight for this conversation. Before I turn it over to Rachel, a few logistics. If you haven't read The Feminist War on Crime yet, you can find a link to purchase the book on our website, law.nyu.edu/BWLN, and it will also be posted in the chat if it's not already there. We will be taking questions via the Q&A box, so please submit your questions and we'll get to as many as we can. Automatic captioning is available for this event, and if you wish to access the captions, please click the closed captioning button. And now to introduce Rachel. Dr. Rachel Wechsler is a research fellow at the Zimroth Center on the Administration of Criminal Law at NYU. Her research focuses on the state's responses to gender-based violence. Prior to joining the Zimroth Center, Rachel was an acting assistant professor and the associate director of the lawyering program at NYU Law, for which she received the Podell Distinguished Teaching Award in 2020. She earned her doctorate in criminology from the University of Oxford and her JD from the University of Pennsylvania Law School. Prior to pursuing her doctorate in criminology at the University of Oxford, she worked as a litigation associate at Latham & Watkins, LLP, where she chaired the pro bono asylum program for the New York office. With that, over to you, Rachel.
Thanks for the introduction, Madeline, and for having me. I'm going to start by introducing Aya Gruber, who I'm thrilled to be in conversation with today about her book. Aya Gruber is the Ira C. Roth Gerber Professor of Constitutional Law and Criminal Justice at the University of Colorado Law School, where she teaches criminal law, criminal procedure, and critical theory. As a lifelong feminist, a former public defender, a professor of criminal law for 18 years, and a survivor, she has personally and professionally grappled with the issue of feminism's influence on criminal law for decades. Professor Gruber received her BA in philosophy from UC Berkeley, summa cum laude, and her law degree, magna cum laude, from Harvard Law School, where she was an editor of the Harvard Women's Law Journal and founder of the Interracial Law Students Association. After law school, Professor Gruber clerked for US District Court Judge James L. King in Miami, Florida, and then served as a felony trial attorney with the Public Defender Service in Washington, DC, and the Federal Public Defender in Miami. Thanks so much, Aya, for joining me tonight. I'll get started because I know we have a lot to talk about. So first, I want to ask about your inspiration and journey in writing this book. I know you've been writing at the intersection of feminism, gender-based violence, and criminal law for many years now, including your 2007 Law Review article that also entitled The Feminist War on Crime, and that you've also reflected on these issues during your time as a public defender. Could you tell us about your intellectual journey in developing this work?
Yes. So first of all, thank you so much, Rachel, for having this conversation with me. And I also want to thank Claire Whitman, Madeline Giori, and the inimitable Melissa Murray for, you know, having me here and giving me a chance to connect with these two amazing centers that, you know, I really see my book at the intersection of both of their projects. So thanks. I think that the inspiration for this book was a lifetime in the making. So, I mean, as long as I can remember growing up, I had, which is kind of weird for a little kid when you think about it, but I had had this real deep skepticism, like bordering on fear, of government detention programs. And I think part of that was that my mother had been in a World War II internment camp, right, on the basis of her race and ethnicity, right, for being Japanese. So I think there was always this sense I had of, you know, I'm not sure all these stories I'm hearing in elementary school about officer friendly are really the case. So I always had that, and I started, you know, I was one of those kids who was like an intern at the public defender at 14, and this was totally my purview. At the same time, I was, in my mind, you know, a feminist. I really was sort of horrified at that time about the thought of, you know, gender-based violence against women, women's lack of, you know, opportunities, women's economic marginality, and especially, you know, in high school and in college, this is all going on through my head. And it finally came to sort of a real conflict point in law school. I, you know, on the one hand, you know, have these very public defender-y type of thoughts. And in fact, I was in the clinic there and I had planned on becoming a public defender after law school. But at the same time, I had these, you know, notions about feminism. I was really involved in the Battered Women's Advocacy Project and other projects, and had experienced, you know, sexual violence myself. But I realized that, you know, I didn't realize it till later, but at the time, now I look back on it and realize that I had a very specific notion of feminism. So for me, I don't know where I had developed this. I wasn't a women's studies major, but it was just in the ether that, you know, women were widely subordinated, right? Which is true, that the source of that subordination was mostly individual bad male actors, and that those actors, you know, engaged in criminal violence. So therefore, rape and domestic violence were the measure of women's inequality, and they needed to be stamped out one incarcerated man at a time. And, you know, this is a very, now I know this is a very specific dominance feminist notion of women's equality, but I adhered to it so much that when I was a prospective public defender, I was more worried about representing a man charged with misdemeanor domestic violence than representing somebody charged with murder. And, you know, I wrote about it early on as a student. I called it the feminist defense attorney dilemma. And I felt really deeply mired in it until I started actually practicing in a domestic violence court. And then my dilemma kind of went away, because what I saw was, yes, gender violence is a problem, but this carceral system that feminists had built to be especially enlightened was just more of the same of criminal misdemeanor court. People of color saddled with collateral consequences, saddled with jail time, saddled with loss of custody. You know, I saw prosecutors prosecuting cases against victims' wishes, right? And even treating victims like, you know, I know what's better for them than they do. You know, I saw immigrant women who lamented that their call to the police for help, for violence intervention, triggered this massive carceral machine that made their spouses and sometimes them deportable. You know, I saw women jailed because the police came in and they saw some evidence in the home, right? Like this exploded the privacy of their homes, which feminism is supposed to do. But when the privacy of their home was exploded, what the police decided to do was sweep up the women if they were engaged in any, you know, like private criminal activity or, you know, something that they could classify as abuse and neglect, which we know is related to women's marginality and poverty. So anyway, I saw all this and then I wondered, you know, why for so long I had entertained just such a carceral vision of women's empowerment, right? Such a disciplinary top-down vision. And I think when I became a professor and, you know, had more time as a public defender to look into these issues, I just started to really be fascinated with kind of my own dilemma. And that's kind of where my work flowed from there.
Thanks so much for sharing that. So this book is really truly a lifetime in the making. And one thing that I really appreciate about you and about your writing and your speaking is that you're not afraid to grapple with the difficult questions, and you're also willing to be, you know, open about your journey and your grappling. And I think that is great just as a role model. I feel like as feminists, if we're going to be able to address these really complex issues, we need to not shy away from potentially needing to adjust our positions in the future or potentially needing to revisit certain things. And that, you know, in certain contexts, especially in this world of social media and the internet, where, you know, nothing ever disappears and people love to point out when other people, you know, shift their views on something or evolve, I think we should be actually encouraging this type of evolution and this type of reflection. And I really appreciate you as a role model for other feminists and people who care about these issues to do the same and be transparent about it. So thank you for sharing your journey. And one thing that I really want to point out about this book that I really enjoyed and think is one of the most fantastic contributions is the rich historical context that it provides about feminist activism and the development of laws concerning sexual and intimate partner violence. You're a great storyteller. You make the material really come to life on the page. And I feel like this is a wonderful contribution of the book. So when you were doing this deep dive into the historical material, did you uncover anything that surprised you?
So many things surprised me. And, you know, I realized I had to do it because I had been writing a lot on feminist domestic violence criminal law reform and feminist criminal law rape reform. And it kind of all starts, like all of the histories, if you look at the law review literature, if you look at a lot of the non-historical literature, but the lawyers' literature on it, it all starts around 1960, right? And so the history is kind of like grassroots feminism becomes legal feminism, but you know, that's the moment at which feminist criminal lawmaking was born in most of the histories. And, you know, including in my work, I started there too, right? Like that's where I started. But in writing this book, there were so many unanswered questions. Like, what is that where it started? And why did it start in the place that, you know, we see this feminist law reform starting in? And why did it so quickly go criminal, right? And, you know, I realized that one of the things that kept coming up in feminist criminal law reform and criminal lawmaking was this idea of the absence of law when it came to sexual and gendered violence, violence in the home, right? So that it was truly a situation where the history of crimes against women was one of uniform lack of law and under-enforcement. And so, you know, I accepted that too, right? And this kind of prefigures an almost instinctive sentiment that, well, feminist progress is therefore more law, more jailing, more criminal law, because it makes up for this past of widespread legal tolerance, right? And so, you know, one of the things I wanted to find out, well, is that true? And it turns out that, you know, there's, of course, unsurprisingly, a very rich and complex history of both the criminal regulation of sex crimes and, you know, crimes within families. And it's not one of uniform tolerance and under-enforcement. It's one of, you know, very strict regulation in certain realms, you know, and actually I know that Melissa Murray has written about this too, like very strict channeling of sexual and family activities and gender roles through the criminal law. And what that led to was both under enforcement and over enforcement, depending on the status of the parties, the race and gender of the parties, and the context in which the violence, abuse, or even just sex occurred. So, you know, sort of famously, one thing that people are infamously, I should say, one thing that people are recognizing now is the fraught sort of racial history of anti-rape enforcement. Like that's something that has increasingly been recognized, but was largely left out of the second wave story, was just how much fears of male sexuality figured into tyrannical, oppressive punishments, you know, during the Reconstruction era and after, and continuing into disparities today against Black men, right? So that part is appreciated, but sort of underappreciated is also just how instrumental feminism was to other sexual regulations. The criminalization of underage sex, which, you know, again, we're still having a debate about whether that is good for women, bad for women, protects, you know, kids or subjects, you know, a select amount of kids to the penal machine, whereas other kids have the privilege to be young sexual actors, you know. And it turns out during the progressive era in the 20s, like they had to go on this massive building spree of girls' reformatories for all the girls swept up in, you know, sort of the underage sex dance hall raids and things like this. So, I mean, there's just so much of the story of vice, sex regulation, the positioning of women, both women, white women, women of color, in and out of the feminist movement during that time, that I realized that this story that criminal law is symbolically progress, that's not altogether true. And to the extent that that has pushed this carceral turn in feminism, I wanted to shed some light on that.
Thanks, Aya. And thank you for parsing all of this, you know, dense historical material for all of us and distilling it into very understandable ways that we can also really understand how the thread kind of, you know, is an unbroken thread from earlier times than I think we often think about this development of feminist activism and the anti-rape, anti-domestic violence movements. So I really appreciate that. And it also is a wonderful example, what you just gave, about something that you criticized throughout the book, which is really the lack of nuance and the oversimplification of a lot of these narratives that are driving these reflexive criminal legal responses. So I feel like you do a great job of shining a light on the lack of nuance in various different areas. First, you know, thinking about different types of gender-based violence and the oversimplification and failure to differentiate between severe forms and arguably less severe forms, for example, by putting Aziz Ansari or Al Franken's conduct into the same category as like Harvey Weinstein's. In addition, you highlight the role of disregarding nuance in the development of carceral responses to gender violence, such as the narrative of the sexist Neanderthal cops as an explanation for the lack of arrests in domestic violence situations, and also as a powerful force for establishing these mandatory arrest laws. So I know this is a very complex question, but how do you think we can combat this lack of nuance in our political discourse and the resulting blunt instrument laws and policies that come about as a result?
Yeah, so it's an amazing question. So thank you for that. And you know, two quotes come to mind by some of my favorite scholars. So you know, not quotes, but I'm going to have to paraphrase, but ideas. So Janet Halley at Harvard, who's a gender theorist and a you know, also, you know, controversial in her own right, but a very smart and thoughtful person, has written about how, you know, there's a real challenge for activists when the megaphone becomes the gavel, right? So translating, you know, and you kind of brought this up in the beginning, you know, 150 character tweet, right? You know, activist sound bites, things that are necessary to make change into policies that are administered by a state that, you know, through a system, a criminal system that has these built-in pathologies and mechanism and is so entrenched in many other things, you know, it is something that, you know, maybe the activist using the megaphone isn't thinking so much about. And I think that, you know, it might be worthwhile, especially when it comes to criminal law, to think about the embedded pathologies, the embedded structures, the long history, which also reminds me of a quote from Angela Harris, that who's also an amazing theorist on intersectionality and gender, race, and all kinds of things, labor, political economy. But you know, she said strategies become institutions. And so I think we have to keep that in mind, especially for criminal law, and especially for law that has to do with, in a way, images of preferred victims, and certainly women, white women in particular, and things that we can imagine affecting white women. You know, that is preferred sort of victimhood, right? Like that vision of an ideal victim. You know, so when they affect preferred victims, women, and when they have to do with sex, you know, which is, you know, at the intersection of disgust in society. So disgust for sex or stereotypical raced images of wife beaters. You know, when legislation rolls in on that kind of a wave, it becomes very difficult to reverse. I think all criminal legislation is difficult to reverse, but criminal legislation that is, you know, not only a victory for people who are tough on crime, they love all kinds of criminal legislation, but also is a victory on the left, right? And is supposed to mark the measure of women's progress. That's incredibly hard to reverse. So, you know, maybe this shows my criminal law bias and exceptionalism, but I feel like, especially when it comes to criminal law, which is just such a costly institution, and it's so resistant to change, that we do need to have more nuance, right? And we can recognize that these are terrible individual acts that people do. All crimes are, and especially crimes that entrench and reinforce marginality and subordination based on race, gender, other identities. They're horrible. But at the same time, focusing on the individual's act of horribleness and how disgusting it is what has propped up the American penal state for so long, and has really created what is, I think, a human rights disaster and an embarrassment within the eyes of the world.
I completely agree. And, you know, now that discussions around mass incarceration have become more mainstream, I think your book is incredibly timely and incredibly important, so that we can learn from these historical lessons. And picking up again on this idea about the lack of nuance and the ideal victim, and you're absolutely right. You know, there has been this oversimplification also of the every woman account. And you rightly criticize that in the book, and this erases the experiences of so many other people who are experiencing gender-based violence and other types of violence. And it's, you know, incredibly harmful, and also, you know, in addition to having, you know, women of color and undocumented women and low income women, not only not gaining the attention that their plight deserves, there's also this terrible disproportionate impact on their community. And they're not seen as legitimate victims oftentimes. And your book does an excellent job of shining a light on how race and class are intersecting with gender within this context of gender violence. And one thing that really stands out to me is how you show that this is such an enduring phenomenon. And this comes back to your historical contributions. This is an enduring phenomenon across different types of gender violence, across different time periods, where it's marginalized people who are harmed by the system, you know, victims and defendants and their communities. And this is something, this is a story, no matter what the particular example is you're giving, whether you're talking about domestic violence or rape, campus sexual assault, human trafficking, it seems that it's this, you know, the same refrain that in practice, these over-policed, over-surveilled communities are the ones that are experiencing greater harm, while there can be certain, you know, celebrations within the movement and within politics that we're really doing something here because we've changed this law. But on the ground, there are these disproportionately harmful effects that are impacting a very large proportion of people who have experienced gender violence. I was wondering if you can share your thoughts about this enduring phenomenon and also the implications when there are these calls for criminal prosecutions of people of color who have committed gender violence. And these calls are even by communities of color, as was the case, and I have to bring him up, R. Kelly, you know, is on everyone's mind right now, especially with the verdict last week. So I know I've asked you multiple questions, but I feel like they're all related because we're talking about communities that are most harmed, but when they're saying, okay, now we want you to apply this to somebody from our community, what are the implications of that?
Yeah, so I mean, I'm going to take the first part of your question, which you know, is about sort of the history of the Every Woman, and another shout out to one of my favorite scholars on the subject, Beth Ritchie, who really coined the term Every Woman in her Arrested Justice and other writings, and it's a very helpful concept for anybody who's like interested in, you know, thinking about DV policy. Or elsewhere, because it is how, you know, essentialist notions of different conditions, the female condition, the this condition, can entrench, right, like the higher people on the hierarchy of the subordinated group, right? You see this also in LGBTQ circles where, you know, gay men come to that. So, you know, so I thought that was a very helpful and useful construct. And I just filled it out with some stories because you can draw a straight line between, for example, in 1896, Frances Willard, right, the white woman, middle class head of the Women's Christian Temperance Union, who's responsible for the fact, you know, even today, that the age of consent isn't 10, right? Like, so that's a very good thing, but you can draw a straight line between her really serious debate and cross attempts at public takedowns, right, with Ida Wells, who said, look, you know, in your effort to focus on women and underage sex and the harms of people taking advantage of teens, you have whipped up Southern mobs who are lynching Black men, right? And this made the papers, and this was a big row in 1896. Well, you can draw a straight line from that to the clash between feminists of color and anti-poverty feminists like Johnny Tillman, who was a Black feminist and head of the National Welfare Rights Organization, or other feminists of color, and white battered women's advocates in 1976. So I tell this story where, you know, at these very important Commission on Civil Rights hearing, there's a Latina shelter feminist, right? Somebody who runs Casa de las Madres, which still exists today, but is a little less radical than it was, telling a sort of devastating story about her stepfather murdering her beloved mother. But, you know, it's a surprising diagnosis that she makes. She calls gender-based violence the soil of white supremacy and explains how her stepfather was very loving in the beginning, but being subject to all kinds of abuse as the only Mexican on the job where he worked, turned him into an alcoholic. And then they would get into alcoholic fights. And, you know, of course it's terrible and he's awful for doing this. And she doesn't say it's not awful, but in one of these fights, he stabbed her mother quite brutally and killed her. But she, the shelter feminist, understood this act as the final act. This is kind of paraphrasing a quote, as quote, the final act of a white supremacist society bent on two people annihilating each other. And, you know, in the story, what's significant, and then she asked for all kinds of help for women of color and for women of color in shelters. And what's significant about the story is there was a very prominent sort of second wave feminist, you know, I'm you know, the first woman to wear pants to court, first judge in Philadelphia, you know, a very passionate and amazing person in her own right. She actually stood up to talk out of turn to say, basically, I disagree with everything that the Latina feminist said. This isn't a problem of white society. It's a problem of human society. And she even went so far as to say, to the extent that women of color disproportionately suffer from domestic violence, they should look at their own men and their cultures. So, I mean, this was sort of a moment where, you know, that, you know, like feminists of color, if you want to say something about white supremacy, no, because, you know, that dilutes the message that this is all about men and patriarchy. And your problem is that your men are particularly patriarchal. And so, you know, another person came up and testified and said, look, you know, therefore, AFDC doesn't work for white women because they don't want to be seen as welfare recipients. And also, they'd never get enough welfare money to make it worth it for them to leave. So, you know, like we think arrest is best, the best model. And so, you know, pretty soon, right, the every woman was this white woman separation arrest model. And it's just really interesting how, you know, it's not that the feminists of color weren't saying this is a problem. Right, but they were saying this is a problem that has to do with a lot of intersections. And this was before Kimberly Crenshaw coined intersectionality and nobody was hearing it. I think people are hearing it now, intersectionality. And I think, you know, though, what's interesting to me, and I haven't parsed it out a ton, is that I think people are willing to see sort of the, kind of the judge's point that, you know, if white women suffer from abuse and can't leave abusive relationships and suffer from sexual harm, then Black marginalized women, women of color, Indigenous women, they're doubly affected by this. So sort of that 1 + 1 = 2, right? Like Black women have women's problem equal white women's problem plus they're Black, right? And I think that, you know, that is true, right? Like there's some feeling given this truth that it's even doubly beneficial for women of color to have especially strong criminal laws. It's even more of a victory, right, R. Kelly, because of the fact that women of color suffer more and they're not the missing white woman syndrome, right? They're not Gabby Petito. So when they can get attention and justice, right, through the system, it seems like a particular victory. I call this idea, the idea of getting equal protection from the carceral state. Like it's a victory when I finally got this penal system to take my crime seriously, right? Like that. That feels like a victory. And that's kind of what the feminist notion of criminal law reform has always been based on. You know, I think that that is a symbolic victory, but in many ways it can become a simulacrum of justice, because you know what the criminal system won't do, it will make everyone worse off. It will, except for the feeling of getting justice. Materially, it's not aiding many people, and it is entrenching many of the structural conditions that lead to women of color's vulnerability. So I understand the R. Kelly situation. I just think that, you know, what we end up having in these high profile cases is men, very powerful men, who do really egregious things and get away with them for years because of their power, because of prejudice against victims, because of the thought that, you know, it was consensual because this man was famous or powerful. And I get that. These are terrible situations that, you know, really reflect a lot of problematic, not just gendered, a lot of problematic dynamics. But it would be a mistake to think that when you are changing doctrine, which we are, I mean, the prosecution of R. Kelly was a very novel way to use RICO and Mann Act charges. But when you're changing doctrine to broaden it to a lot of people, we imagine that we're going to take down these untouchable, powerful abusers and liberate the most marginalized women. But in reality, you know, we just end up with a broadened criminal law and all those other dysfunctions that protect the rich and powerful from this system are still there. We've just made the laws that, you know, affect the quote unquote usual suspects, we've just made them much broader and easier for prosecutors to use.
And that's something that you highlight in many different contexts in the book. So I wanna talk to you, I mean, time is just flying by and there's so many interesting questions that I wanna ask you. But I want to make sure we have time for some audience questions. So as we wrap up, I want to ask you about your proposal that we adopt a neo-feminist approach. And you map out some of this. I think it's an important feature is focusing on things like structural determinants and root causes that are creating vulnerability and driving gender violence and driving the mass incarceration problem. One question I had about this approach, and you refer to, I'd love to hear you talk more about what it means when you talk about toppling powerful abusers through political action. And I know you said, you know, you're not at this point giving a blueprint, I know, but you've given us a lot of food for thought. And one thing that I'm wondering about and a little bit concerned about is, since we know we have this problem with a lack of appreciation for nuance, that having it down to political action, that there might be false accusations, rumors, oversimplifications, and that people who are accused might not benefit from due process and just have the mob come after them. And I was just wondering about your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, when you have a situation like Harvey Weinstein, somebody whose harms that he's committing, and you know, apparently it wasn't just women who he sexually abused or he tried to extract sexual labor from by threatening them. It was many people that he abused, you know, in many different ways and extracted unfairly extracted labor from because they were precarious workers, non-unionized workers, you know, people without power. And so, you know, do I feel bad that he got toppled? No, right? Like he was a person who was mired within a totally unfair power structure in a totally, like, in my mind, late stage capitalist market that allows this type of stuff to go on. And also just individually, he was a bad abuser who did have very sexist views about women. So I'm not upset that he got toppled, but his trial did produce some precedents about, you know, prior bad acts witness, some precedents about, you know, what can constitute evidence of lack of consent that are very broad and very pro-prosecution. And if we imagine, so, and we imagine that it was these prosecutorial advantages that toppled Weinstein, it wasn't the prosecutorial advantages that toppled Weinstein. It was the people, right? It was the people. And so what I'm saying is, we're just allowing all these legal changes because these are people who had been protected from the criminal law. And we imagine that it's because the criminal law isn't tough enough. Anybody who studies the criminal law, and there are many people here are far more, have far more expertise than I do on, you know, on globally the criminal law, but it's tough enough. It, you know, especially sex crime law is tough. The advantage prosecutors get are enormous. That's what toppled the abuser, was the people sort of saying, this power dynamic isn't okay. Now, your question is, okay, but like, there could be Twitter justice and Twitter mobs, and that's trial by Twitter, and those can have really bad outcomes too. And I agree with that. They can have bad outcomes. But I think, you know, when it comes to due process, when it comes to anything, we have to look a little bit at what the range of possible outcomes are. What did the person lose? You know, and yeah, I agree. Like one thing that really bothers me about sort of internet discussions of sexual assault and misconduct is there is a undercurrent of sex shaming in there too, which isn't good for women. Just like assuming that sex stuff is, you know, get you canceled. Like, and that to me is not that far away from, you know, other sort of kind of mores that we probably wouldn't want in society. But in terms of like the individual guys that get taken down and how they get taken down, I think that's all subject to looking at the costs and benefits and the processes. But I know this, expanding the criminal law is not going to affect people who are immune from criminal law by their structural advantage.
And you've shown us how this happens over and over again through history and the power dynamics. And I think you raise, you know, bigger questions about neoliberalism and the power dynamics in our society. I want to...
Well, let me just say one more thing. And when you think about it, like when you think about it, then what happens is when you can get someone, right, you pile onto that someone, right? So, you know, so... I mean, there is a real phenomenon of zeal. It's not misplaced, but being concentrated on the easier versus the harder cases.
That makes a lot of sense. I want to make sure we have time for some audience Q&A. And we, so I'd like to ask our listeners to put their questions in the Q&A box, and we'll get to as many of them as we can. We have one question already. A larger theme running through the book is that legal interventions meant to protect women and other marginalized groups can often backfire by ultimately limiting their choices. This is a critique that has also been levied against employment and reproductive rights law that supposedly protect women but actually circumscribe their options. What is your view on the right way to protect marginalized groups? Does law have any place in that effort?
Yes, I mean, I definitely think that law has a place in the effort. Like criminal law, law is an institution. Law has embedded limitations. Engaging in the law is a choice worth thinking about. And that's why, you know, these are all really hard decisions. But I'm not a total exit from the law person. I'm like, yes, use law, but make sure, you know, you have identified the problem in a way that works, and you're realistic about how this law is going to flow in the world. Because, you know, like domestic violence, it's a problem, right? You know, domestic homicides, it's a problem. That's, nobody's going to say that's not a problem. But then just putting into place a bunch of law and assuming that it's going to actually address the problem because, you know, somebody said, I'm doing this for domestic violence, that's a whole different assumption. And I think that people who are lawmakers have an obligation the best they can to try to trace how that law is going to flow in a real world of mass incarceration, economic inequality, gender inequality. So I don't say no law. I totally agree that, you know, these protective laws can backfire, right? It doesn't mean we scrap all laws in the name of protecting women. It means first we can be a little skeptical of some of these women protecting laws, where they really, like, what were they really about? And we should know the genealogies of them. But then, you know, is there any sense that this lawmaker or activist or proponent tried to figure out who might be the winners and losers of this regime with a mind towards intersectionality? Because if they didn't try to figure out the losers, right? Like sometimes they always figure out the winners and it's the imagined group they have. They don't even try to think about the costs of the program. It's not a good idea.
Yeah, the winners tend to be the winners over the long haul, repeatedly again and again. And I think you raised some really important points about how we have to make sure that these laws and practice are actually matching, you know, the normative commitments that we have in trying to implement them. So another attendee has asked, you discuss the problem of what some scholars have dubbed pathological politics, in which social panic about a given issue results in elected officials increasing criminal penalties or creating new crimes, even though existing criminal law already covers the issue, just so they can give the public the sense that they're doing something to address the problem. Given the nature of our political system, where elected officials are constantly looking towards their next election, how can we move away from such a reactive problem-solving approach?
Yeah, so, you know, so that's another one of my favorites, William Stuntz, who wrote The Pathological Politics of Criminal Law. And actually, one of the examples he used was sort of like the outrage over vice or drugs, and you know, and it's not that it is that like criminal law already addresses these issues, but there's this kind of pile on in criminal law, and most of the people who feel effects of that pile on, that broadening, that sort of like going even the extra, have nothing to do with the segment of society that was concerned about it, right? Like so his theory is, you know, there's a small concentrated marginalized, usually people of color and poor segment that actually will feel the practical effects of these symbolic federal, for example, laws. You know, a perfect example is how during like sex panic, child sex panics, you know, the sex offense laws became totally federalized. And the end result of the federalization of these laws was like much tougher penalties for an array of sex offenses than were in the states. And who's subject to federal sex offense law? I mean, maybe people in, you know, like on park property, you know, national park property, but no, the disproportionate impact on Native American, accused Native Americans, accused Indigenous people, was really stark, right? So it's very interesting. I think there is this problem of symbolic criminal laws, which I think has been identified for a long time. Can you intervene with politicians? I'm not the expert on intervening with politicians, but I can say this. One of the criticisms I sometimes get is like, why are you beating up on feminists, right? When there are so many like conservative and like non, you know, social justice actors you can beat up. And I don't mean to beat up on feminists. Like I mean to say it from a point of view of, I feel like one of you, which is why I endorse neo-feminism and not post-feminism or take a break from feminism. I feel that sense of there being gender subordination, right? That needs to be remedied. But at the same time, I want to intervene with you because I think people on the left may underestimate the extent to which these left incursions into the criminal apparatus serve to prop up and legitimize this whole process, this pathologically political and otherwise pathological process. I think it might do that more than people think. So that's why I'm kind of like intervening with people I think might listen. So, yeah.
Yes, and prop up the existing hierarchies. And, you know, I think that's actually really wise to try to help people who have maybe the same goals that you have some shared goals, but to think about how we can better achieve those goals without all the collateral consequences. So this is a great question, I think, to wrap up. It gives you a chance to talk more about your neo-feminist approach. One of the attendees asks, how can non-attorneys or even law students help move this thinking forward?
Well, I think the thinking is moving forward. I remember sort of around 2012 is when the whole Title IX, you know, campus anti-rape movement sort of took off. And that was in the wake of explosive reports of predatory behavior. And, you know, there's been a lot of analysis on the sort of, you know, violence against white women and elite women sort of syndrome in that area. But when it seems to me, and this is just anecdotally being a person who's been involved in those conversations, that in the beginning, it was very top-down disciplinary and pretty darn carceral. It was like, well, the reason we have to go to Title IX is that police officers mistreat rape victims, which is not untrue. They do. But, you know, sort of presupposing if these are really horrific crimes that should go to the criminal system, and if the criminal system were only better, it could give us the justice that we want, which was, you know, a pretty carceral frame, right? A pretty much a frame of, you know what women need in the face of these inequalities and subordination is some jail, right? Which is like just an institution of sexual violence, just, you know, rampant inequality, hierarchy, sexual violence, gender violence, you know, race-based violence, all kinds of violence. Nowadays, at least quite a few of the Title IX activists have, you know, a real vocabulary of intersectionality, anti-carcerality, and, you know, envision that, I don't know if I agree with it, but they envision that sort of pumping up the campus discipline system is actually going to drain the criminal system of cases. I think empirically there's more evidence that it doesn't work that way, but the sensibility is coming from a much more anti-carceral space. Now, maybe that's just a post-George Floyd phenomenon, and we're still, you know, just interrupting myself, the quickness with which the post-George Floyd change of mindset is dissipating is just so upsetting and disturbing. But, you know, and maybe this will similarly dissipate, but I see a real sea change. And I think it has to come from feminists to other feminists.
And to also talk about these really complex issues with the level of nuance that they deserve, and that is required to actually develop solutions that are not only going to be symbolic, but also be equitable on the ground, which I think is a real challenge.
Yeah, I will say that, you know, you're calling for a lot of nuance and discussion, but, you know, I was even recently in a sort of author meets reader session where, and I'm used to this from like 20 years ago when questioning, you know, mandatory arrest and domestic violence, that there's a series of disciplinary methodologies that, you know, activists and feminists use to discipline alternative voices. You know, you weren't there, you don't know what you're talking about, you know, you're not a victim, this is going to move women back, and just kind of a very rigid disciplining of the conversation, right? You're causing harm to people even by speaking. You know, what's not the feminist truth. And I think we have to be very careful about that. I mean, and I probably do it too. Right? Like, I know in ways I do it too, but I think, you know, people on the left, people in social justice movements can so easily eat their own. And I just think we need to be generous with each other, that we're all, you know, trying to figure out what's right in a world that is just, it feels like the problems are compounding exponentially every day.
And on that uplifting note, I want to thank you so much, Aya, both for this conversation and for your wonderful work. And I'm also excited to see, you know, I know you just wrote a book, which is a huge project, but I'm also excited to see how you're going to build on this and further the conversation in the future, because I think you've really helped push us forward in our thinking about these issues. I think we have to wrap up, but yes, thank you so much.
Well, thank you again so much for having me. It was great to connect with everybody. And if anybody had a question that they didn't get to ask, feel free to email me.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Professor Aya Gruber and Rachel Wechsler, for tonight's conversation. And thank you so much to our audience for joining us tonight. We hope you'll join us for some upcoming events. Thanks again and have a wonderful evening. Good night.